signs?
Two, seven, two, 15, nothing headed east.
So if the council's okay with eight signs, yeah.
The only input I have on that is say, 6 years from now, there's some signs missing. The council wants to say, what did you do? How do you document what we chose to do? You know what I mean?
If it's not written specifically.
Yeah, if it's not written specifically in here, you get to where somebody's like, well, the signs are gone. Because I'm sure that happened. How do we remember what we chose to do, right?
There should be a, if I remember right, isn't there a book, mayor, maybe director, can you answer that? Isn't there some type of log or something, I remember, of where all of the signs were?
It's in the code.
It's in the code? Okay. So is that suffice though? So in the code, it would have the streets?
This wasn't put forth as a code change.
Well, our, like our no parking signs, it's all listed.
You're young, mayor, you're here in 6 years.
It's a good point, Rick.
You know, you're saying they're in there, that they're just documented, so you know what they were.
Yeah, they should be documented somewhere, you would think.
It's just they want to just change it.
And then from there, we could just amend this to where it just states signs and leave out the street.
It'll be in the minutes.
Yeah, that's what I was gonna say, it'll be in the minutes.
Tiffany got all.
Okay, there you go.
It's all in the minutes.
So when we get to that section, we just need to amend it and go from there. There you go, that's all you, John. All right, anything else on that topic?
I think we just were bringing up the conversation with, obviously outside the business district, because some of the concern is how they come to the business district if there's a, I just feel the strongest about the safety of the bike lanes as they're laid out with the cars anyways, but there's also an extra wide sidewalk that happens to be in the business district, so it's kind of funny. There we have these big wide sidewalks, but then in the residentials are off the business district, now you're on a 4 foot wide sidewalk and there's a lot of bike, that's why it was just more clarification with that. But some of the clarification too was the e-bikes, the whatever they're referred to as those being on the sidewalks.
So the e-bikes or bicycles with electric or any type of power assist are not allowed on the sidewalks anywhere in the city.
And that's per the vehicle trackable.
Correct.
Unless we specify they are.
Correct.
So just as we look down the road, if we start having some of these shared use paths that are 10 feet wide, we would have to explicitly state they're allowed from point A to point B.
Yes.
Right?
Yes, the assisted ones.
Right.
But then the bicycles are allowed on the sidewalks in non-business district.
Correct. Regular bicycles. So if your kids want to ride a bicycle on the sidewalk in a residential area, that's allowed.
Which my concern is not bicycles. Yeah. I mean, I'm actually more in favor of bicycle being allowed on the sidewalk. Like I said, even in the business district, it's wide enough, it's far safer than some of the narrow streets having bicycles with children on them out into the roadways. So, you know, it's more of that, the larger, faster ones that you see on the sidewalks now. But I think you clarified it with it against the vehicle and traffic law, so, you know, if that can be enforced, then so be it.
Okay.
Thanks, Ron.
All right, so we're good.
I've got one more question.
Yep, go ahead, John.
Thank you. Chief, what is the vehicle, what does the traffic law state as far as these electric bikes that, I mean, I saw, I mean, they are, they're going 30, 40 miles an hour. I understand they have to comply with, you know, the New York State traffic laws, but do they, are they treated like motorcycles? Do they have to be licensed? Do they?
No. There are different classes of bicycles, electric bikes, whatever you want to call them. There are different classes. I mean, they are dangerous. In the past year, we've had two fatalities.
Really?
With electric bikes, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then recently, another serious injury, too.
Oh, if you're referring to one, 6th and State.
recently, a couple weeks back.
I'm not familiar with that.
Did you hear it?
No. I don't know if there's, if you have any ideas, if there's anything that we can do from a council standpoint, I don't know. I mean, I think it's New York State law that kids still have to wear helmets.
Yes.
Under a certain age, correct?
Yes.
Do you have to wear helmets to ride electric bikes?
No.
And is that something that is governed by New York State, or is that something that can be governed by a local municipality?
I would have to research that. I don't know that answer.
And I don't know if we want to get into that, okay? Freedom of liberty and all that, so. But maybe if you get a chance to get some information on that for us, Chief.
Okay.
That would be great. Thank you.
All right, well, that is the end of that one. We are going to vote on that one tonight, so I guess we're all set. So we're going to move on. Approval of committee reports. We have none. So I'll make a motion to adjourn. Can I get a second? Second by Alderman Anastasia. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed. And we are adjourned.
I know you.
Okay.
I can't make this quick.
Okay.
But it's recorded. I'll get this recording off later to you. It's letters of mine.
Okay.
I call the order of committee of the whole for Tuesday, July 25th, 2023. Let the record show that all aldermen are present, with the exception of Alderwoman Forney, who is excused. First on our agenda is a South Union Street project update.
Evening. So last time you asked for an update on it, I told you we were awaiting a final revised estimate from CPL. We have that now. I did meet with them back on the 19th. We went over the status of it, so I'll cover that here briefly. The schedule, we're still right on track here. We're going to have another public meeting early September when we have the final design. Right now the design is about 85%. So once that's complete, we're going to put out the public notice. We're going to meet with all interested citizens and residents of the area and show them what we did, show them how we took their concerns and incorporated into the design. So that'll be early September. Then it'll be followed by a bidding over the winter and looking to start in early spring. So one of the concerns that had come up last time was, where are we at? This was budgeted originally years ago at this point. All the inflation we've had and whatnot, and it is much higher now. But given what Kerry Kerper said last time, being able to take the money from West State Street DRI and roll it over here, it's going to come out pretty even. We had 1.4 for this and 1.6 for West State Street to the total of $3 million. The estimate we've got right now is 2.957. So we're within $43,000 of it. So that in there has some, you know, field change contingencies in there, so we've got a little bit of buffer in there in case something goes wrong, but that puts us right on track. One of the things we talked about in this design, CPL is going to go back and take a look at, and I'll get to that in a second, but that may take some of that 43, but certainly not all of them. So as far as the design, the biggest concern we had on this had to do with the median. Most of the residents were upset over that. We went back, took a look at it. There is a median up the middle of it, but there is no raised median to speak of at this point. The only spot where that remains is going into the roundabouts, i.e. the existing one up here at the corner of State South Union, and it's directed traffic into the roundabout. And then back on Green Street, where there's a proposed roundabout, there is the entry medians coming into there. The rest of it is at-grade median, more or less. So this accommodates all the businesses on the south end, have to park there. Union Sales, Marie's and whatnot, who have to have the truck traffic in there. So we did listen to that. We addressed the driveway issues, made some concessions there, and we also have in this is a repair of sidewalk on the west side. Obviously we're not ripping out the new areas where we put sidewalk in, but all the other areas we're going to update in this one. So we're not changing the lights. We've got some trees coming out due to the new path, and the widening of the, you know, the bump outs, and then we're replacing trees also. So that is it in a nutshell, except it was discussed at length when we come all the way down the road here from Union Street. We've got a roundabout, and then for the roundabout we have a traffic light there. And they're going to take a look at it and see if that is worth it or not. So that may be what some of that 43 is used at, see if we can eliminate that or not based on the traffic data. And that, because right now you come all the way down from the hospital, all the way down, all roundabouts, and you just hit a light. And then go to another roundabout. So it's not quite ideal. So we're looking at streamlining that.
Oh, that's at Hennepin Street.
Yes.
Yeah.
So they're going to go take a look at that and come back to us on what they should do on that. So that is where we are on South Union. Are there any questions? Yes, sir.
If you remove that, I know it's premature, but then would that just be a right only like these other ones up through here?
They got to look and see what it supports. Just don't know at this point. I asked where the roundabouts are going right now. He said the old rule of thumb, which we all, I think, have heard, was about $1 million a roundabout. He said it's much higher now. So if you want to throw another one in there, give him the grades to it, you could probably come close to doubling the project. So I don't know if we want to go there.
This does include a shared use path.
This has the path on the east side.
East side, right?
Yep, home pass reads and all the way up by the park. Again, there'll be another public comment in early September when we have a closer design.
Any questions?
Yeah, I think we brought this up a couple weeks ago. I thought there was going to be some infrastructure work there, but you had said it's not really going to be like any sewer lines replaced. It's just
no. A lot of that stuff that's under there is a combination of one that wasn't too old or doesn't need to be replaced or it's not going to be touched. But we are tying in and abandoning some water lines on the north end of the project because of that to pick into the newer lines. But the rest of it up through there isn't that bad.
Okay, and in the medium, is there going to be grass, or is it going to be flower beds like North Union Street?
No, there won't be a raised medium like that at all.
Oh, it's not?
No, it'll be like going down like West State Street.
Fire hall, right?
How about a fire hall? Okay.
Yeah.
Which I think is, I think aesthetically, you know, to balance out, that's kind of the look at that end.
Sure.
Having that at the other end too, right? Having the flower planters are great. So, I think that would look nice.
And that was the biggest concern for the businesses down there.
Yeah.
Was that ability to be able to unload the trucks there and turn and whatnot.
And this is about $3 million that you said, 1.4 and 1.6. Is this grant money that we already have, or is this money that the city's going to have to contribute towards? Or?
This was the DRI grant money.
So it's not, no city funding, it's grant money.
The DRI grant money is at $3
million. We have the front. We've eventually hit it back. New York City.
Well, most grants are that way. You get reimbursed.
Do we ever get stiffed on these grants?
No, I don't believe so.
The state won't stiff you.
The only thing that's concerning is if it just takes longer, right? The longer it takes, the less our dollars worth. So,
as long as we meet all of the requirements with what's that?
The procurement requirements?
Yeah, and the MWBE, and there's some other few in there, but they set the amount, like 30% this, 10% of women-owned companies, and then now I think it's 8% of veteran-owned companies. So as long as we meet all of those, then we get our reimbursement. And Carrie is very good and keeping track of that and making sure we're meeting those goals.
Okay, this is my last comment. You all know how I feel about
roundabouts.
You all know how I feel about roundabouts. I think they're terrible. The dimension that somebody created, it should be shot. But anyways, I'm thinking we could save $1 million if we don't put a roundabout in on Green Street and North Union Street. So if a roundabout is in there, my vote's going to be no, because I think these roundabouts are terrible. My personal opinion.
Okay, sir. So noted.
Yes,
I got a couple of things I wanted to add. I'm not anti-roundabouts. I grew up with them in D.C., and like I said, ours are two, three lanes wide. Olean would have a fit if they had something like that here. But I think we do have enough roundabouts in the city. For once, I'm going to actually agree with Anastasia.
It's recorded.
It's a hot mess, really. I think if the plan is to put in two roundabouts, I think if we can eliminate one, but I'm not the engineer. I don't know if that would create a backlog of traffic or anything. I'm just saying I am for that project. I can't wait for it to start and get done. Anything in Olean is a better place I'm always for. But yeah, if we could save $1 million on a roundabout, that's just $1 million that I feel could go to infrastructure.
All right, let me clarify. There were originally talking to, there is only one in here.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, the Henley one is not on the table.
Oh, okay.
And okay. The roundabouts were part of the traffic calming elements that the grant was based on. So we start pulling out the last one, we're going to have start having trouble for how we qualify for the DRI.
Yep.
So I'd really be cautious about that.
The other thing I wanted to make, thank you, Director. The other thing I wanted to make note of, as when we talk in the Public Safety Committee and we're talking about the bikes and the sidewalk and this and that, and granted, I'm the chair of Public Safety, and I think about those things all the time. I also think about the fact that when we're doing these upgrades, here we are talking about creating shared use paths and bringing people to downtown. So what are they supposed to do when they get downtown? Get off their bikes and walk them? So that's where I get to, it's like, what are we doing here? So I just wanted to bring that up and put that out there that I think while we're creating all of these paths, or we're gonna do Wayne Street, we're gonna do this one here. We're talking about state and we can't get the money for that one, but if we could, we would. And we're talking about shared use paths there. We're talking about all of these things that are gonna bring people from the roads or from the side roads and everything to downtown. But once you get downtown, I hope we have a lot of places to put these bikes to lock them up, and you know, you're not gonna be able to do anything with them. So I just wanted to add that small bit there.
I mean, why are we not gonna be able to do anything with them, right? Because we just got done saying, we can explicitly allow them, right, to be on certain paths.
Mm-hmm.
Right, so I guess I envision that you can go on your electric scooter or your bicycle or on foot from Franchot Park down South Union Street to Lincoln Park, down East State Street to War Vets Park, right, on a designated shared use path. If you've got to go downtown, we do have bike lanes. They're less than ideal, we all know that.
Mm-hmm.
But they are there. You can't redo the downtown at this point. So I hear what you're saying, but I think we have to look at how we fix that once we have this infrastructure there.
Yeah, it's going to have to be revisited. I mean, I don't anticipate being here another 20 years, but I think that's something that the council is going to have to revisit to make sure that it's corrected, that it's done right that way. When families come downtown, they don't have to worry about their child being in the street at a roundabout on a poorly designed bike path. So.
I mean, I hope to be able to see Alderman Anastasia, you know, ride on his electric scooter down his bike boulevard, down North Olean,
yeah,
that
would
he
be
put
great.
In, and
yeah.
Hop on and be able to, you know, scoot around to all the different parks and go to music and Thursday in the park. And, listen to the generations. Any other questions for Director Thompson? Okay, seeing none, thank you, Director Thompson. We've got PL 65-23 by Mayor Alia to authorize the transfer of $1,327.99 from the general fund contingency to line item 1410.411 for costs associated with the purchase of credit card readers and a receipt printer.
Thank you. As you all know, we're trying to become more efficient in all of our departments, and they've recently changed who the company is that takes credit card or that processes the credit cards. And Frank would like to talk about now the need for a couple more credit card readers and one more not have, that was a budget for, so we don't have a budget to cover it. So we're requesting this money from contingency to complete this purchase. So Frank, go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, Mr. President. Clerk's office currently has two workstations to deal with the public and one workstation under the umbrella in the vitals office. We recently changed vendors on the credit card processing, as the mayor mentioned. The addition of, with the additions requested in the resolution, we would have one card reader at each workstation and one printer, a VC printer at each workstation. And this would greatly increase efficiency in the office among the workers, especially in vitals, which is actually two offices, and every time a credit card transaction comes in, she has to run back and forth several times. And it lowers the transaction time, which would lessen consumer wait time in the office as well.
Okay.
About a third of our transactions are credit card, and that seems to be shifting towards credit cards. So this would help us on a lot of levels.
Any comments or questions? Alderman Robinson.
The printers, are they Bluetooth? Are the card readers all Bluetooth with the printers, or are they hardwired?
They're all hardwired. And actually, Jason might be the, he's the one who installed the last printer. The, when we changed vendors, they gave us one free card reader, and Jason and Jerry installed it.
So is it much they more expensive for a Bluetooth-enabled printer?
Oh, we have a hub to our network right now.
Oh, there you go. So it's on the network, so it should
because
be...
Because when they swipe the card, the reader processes it to the payment processor, and that goes to our network.
So the $1,327.99 is for three printers and three card readers?
We have one brand-new printer that Jason just installed. That came with the change in the vendors. This would add two printers and one, two card readers and one printer,
and one receipt printer. Okay.
Which would have, each workstation would have one of each.
Including vitals, they would have one card.
Yes, absolutely. Actually, vitals is the thing that drove this. She's running back and forth.
Right. Any thoughts on this, Alderman Anastasia, given your background in that office?
No, I think it's a great idea. Yeah, I just think it should have been budgeted, but maybe he didn't know it was coming up. But I think it's a great idea, and we have money in surplus, and that's what the surplus money's for.
Okay, sounds good. Any other comments or questions? Seeing none, I'll entertain a sponsor.
I'll sponsor.
Okay.
I'll second.
All right. Alderwoman McCall, and second by Alderman Anastasia. All in favor? Aye. Opposed? Motion carried. Referred to tonight's regular meeting. PL 66-23 by Alderman Bending to authorize the installation of stop signs on Front Street at its intersection with Prospect Avenue. Alderman Bending.
We talked about this, I don't know, 12, 14 weeks ago when we first talked about it for the high volume of traffic along Front Street, the safety concerns about making cross traffic maneuvers, left hand turns off from Prospect and Spring. So those PLs are just a culmination of that topic.
Okay. Any comments or questions? Okay. Seeing none, I'll entertain a sponsor.
I'll sponsor.
Okay.
I'll second.
Second by Alderman Robinson. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carried and is referred to tonight's regular meeting.
Excuse me.
Okay, at your request, I took a look at the traffic data here. This was a little difficult because We have some unique situations. We redid Union Street, finishing in 2017, and then COVID pretty much shut down traffic, so it's a very narrow data set here. There's no data for 21 and 22 yet because DOT takes time to process this. So we're looking at the data from 18 and 19 as the only valid data set. I was able to get the data for 18 and partial on 19. So what you do is when you take this data, you compare it against several criteria that's in the manual uniform traffic control devices and how you assess this. So we looked at the types of roads they were, crash data, if there's a crash problem, and then there's a volume issue, and then also your stopping site distances. So looking, I'll take you through this one by one here, but first off, this failed to meet the criteria for the stop sign. I'll be upfront with you on that. It did not meet the criteria. So multi-way stops under the design manual are intended for the volume of traffic intersecting roads are approximately equal. So the idea is if you perhaps over on like Bishop and Queen, that's where you would have a multi-stop sign. That's not really what these are geared for on this type of street. You're not trying to stop the main street to accommodate the smaller one with stop signs. It's just not how it's set up to do. The crash problem is only indicated if you have five or more crashes in the last 12 months. And the last 5 years, we've had a total of five on at the corner there, let's say Prospect, two in the last 12 months. So it doesn't meet the crash criteria. For the volume, there's two requirements there. One, you have to have over an 8 hour period averaged out, at least 300 vehicles an hour for the 8 hours. It does meet that on Front Street. The second criteria is the incoming street, which would be Prospect, which has to meet the 200, which it does not meet. It doesn't mean it comes to maybe half of that. So it has to be one and the other. So it fails the criteria for the volume. The other part would be a stopping site distance, which we don't have an issue there. We do farther down by the railroad tracks, but we don't have it there. So with the data we have, it does not warrant it. And that would be the same for Spring Street. And then if we're going to talk later, Seneca Street down on the agenda actually was put in because of the stopping site distance there, because of the tracks and the geometry of the road. So that's why it was warranted there. And then we have another concern. It has to do with the ambulances. In fact, this is the main route through there for our outlying towns. I don't know if you want to talk about that, Jim.
So the east end of Olean is serviced primarily by Central Fire on North Union Street, and really the only route to get to the east end is Front Street. So it kind of sparked some concerns for me as if there's one or two stop signs on Front Street, what's that going to do to our emergency response? I don't know how it would look. I can envision it. I kind of relate it to 12th Street. So just some background. Coming from Central, going west, we used to take Union Street to State Street. Well, now we avoid Union Street because of the roundabouts, which funnels a lot of emergency vehicle traffic onto 12th Street, which is a narrow residential neighborhood with multiple stop signs. So that's kind of how I envision this on Front Street is. It might make our travel east a little bit more difficult. And then also another important thing to factor in is you have a lot of ambulances from jurisdictions outside of the city to the east coming to Olean in general, and they all take Front Street. To the extent that if there's a water main break or anything like that along East State, Seneca, or Front Street, my office or one of my officers usually lets dispatch know so that they can reroute all the ambulance traffic up the Dugan and down Genesee. So I don't have a clear answer as far as how it's going to look, how it's going to affect our traffic, but I think it is a concern. And it really ties in with what you talked about with, you know, reducing the speed to 25 miles an hour throughout the city too, is, you know, how is that going to affect us? So, you know, I'm pro-safety. You know, slower streets means less accidents, theoretically, but you have to balance that against, steady flows of traffic and safe traffic. In our training doctrines, in our driving training doctrines, they all talk about knowing your first due jurisdiction, knowing the safest, most appropriate routes to get from point A to point B the quickest, and to start slowing down every main artery in the city with stop signs and reduce speed limits. I'm not sure if I can support that.
Okay.
Okay, so PL 66-23, stop sign at Front Street and intersection with Prospect Avenue was passed and it's referred to tonight's regular meeting. PL 67-23 by Alderman Benyon to authorize the installation of stop signs on Front Street at its intersection with Spring Street. Alderman Benyon?
Nothing further. I'll sponsor it.
Okay. So I'd like to, are there any conversation? Alderman McCall?
So in talking about the ambulances, and this may be an incorrect assumption, but if they have their lights on and such, they don't have to stop at stop signs, correct?
New York State law permits us to go through a stop sign after we've taken what's called due regard for safety. So in most cases in the city, we come to almost a complete stop, if not a complete stop. We actually verify, you know, if the cross traffic has multiple lanes, we will verify each lane before we proceed through that perpendicular lane that it is safe to pass. So, you know, us coming to a stop isn't necessarily the issue. It would be the fact that, you know, we would have to go out and around, you know, possibly, you know, on any given time, there might be six cars backed up at a stop sign as they're going through. So now we would have to navigate around, you know, a group of traffic and then back to, into our own lane and then do that again at the next couple blocks down. And then, you know, the ambulances and the police cars, I think, are probably a lesser concern than the fire engines and ladder truck, just because of their size.
I'll make a comment on this particular one. And I had talked to Alderman Benyon about this as well. You know, these are going to be potentially significant changes to Front Street and the traffic pattern. And I grew up, I remember, I believe it was a three-way stop at Prospect, and it does seem like a natural place to try that out and put that back. The thing with these things, we can always put them in, we can always take them out if they don't work. But I'm putting two stop signs in on a fifth busiest street. I just am not in favor of the second stop sign. At this point in time, I would prefer to take it one step at a time insert one stop sign, see how that works, how the community responds to it. So I'm not going to be in favor of this stop sign at Spring Street, although I do understand the logic behind it. Anyone else? Alderman McCall?
I'm going to say I actually understand the logic behind it too. And Alderman Benny and I had talked about this on a few occasions. I can see the concern because I see it on the narrow streets, like on 12th Street, because there's not a lot of space on Front Street, and I can see it when they do have to go behind around cars and such on some of the side streets. And I guess I would wonder now, with some clarification, particularly about fire engines and having to kind of go out and around and then literally in like two or three blocks go out and around again, the safety issues that might present with.
Alderman Robinson.
I'm gonna flip to the opposite side. I wanna say, you know, I understand fire department is in their concern, and all of the emergency vehicles in their concerns with traveling Front Street. Particularly, I don't think that street is as narrow as 12th. But again, I'm not an engineer. When I look at it from a safety perspective, and I say, I'm going to take your quote, you said it was the fifth busiest street in Olean. And so when I think about that, and I try to imagine, I was just sitting here, I didn't want to get on my phone, but when you look at the traffic or the length of the street from Parking Shop all the way down to Seneca, that's a long way. So for the fifth busiest street in Olean, there's no break or stop there. North Union and State both have more breaks in a shorter distance than that section right there. So why is it so, you know, inappropriate or unwarranted to put something there? The director just mentioned something. I kind of missed the exact wording, but he just said something about there wasn't enough volume. So again, if there's not enough volume, then a fire engine shouldn't have a hard time getting through. I do understand, again, with the stop signs and then all of a sudden having vehicles backing up. But we have to look at it from this aspect. If we're having kids down there, we're having a lot of close calls, because that's what brought this up in the first place. There were a lot of close calls. There's issues at Spring Street with kids trying to cross the street to get to school. You can do all the traffic studies you want right now. There's no school. School starts back up in another month and a half. So with that, you know, the kids are going down that way, depending on which way they're crossing. I'm definitely for any stop sign, especially in that region, because it does slow down traffic. I know we've heard numerous times you shouldn't use stop signs as a traffic tool. I get it. But why can't it help the police department? If the police department isn't there because they're out working somewhere else, what other measure do we have to put in place to help with slowing down the traffic than to install a stop sign? What are we doing? We're saving ourselves, you know, or we're losing a minute, maybe 30 seconds at stopping between the two. I mean, aren't we always saying that we need to slow down? We need to start watching for others. I mean, that's all I want to add to that. I just think there's nothing wrong with slowing things down a little bit.
Okay. Alderman Anastasia.
The other thing I would say too is I agree with everything Renee just said, so I'm not going to repeat everything, so not to delay the meeting. But just to play devil's advocate with the ambulance calls, if there is any, if their cars are already stopped at a stop sign, it seems like to me, I don't know, it would be safer for the vehicle. The traffic's already stopped, and all they got to do is go around it, and they're already stopped at the other end. So making smoother access to where they're going, because the vehicles are already stopped at these intersections. That's just plain devil's advocate. But I will second this resolution if you need a sponsor. And I talked to JL quite at length on these topics. I'm in favor of the first two, putting the two stop signs up. I am not in favor of removing one on Seneca Street, because I've been on Seneca Street before trying to get on the front street, and it's almost impossible waiting there forever. If you put on Seneca Street, try to get on the front without that stop sign.
Now you can do it on Spring.
So now I just think that I'll support the first two, but I'm going to support the removal of Seneca.
I
just wanted to comment as far as trying to compare front to 12th Street is a little bit of a stretch for me. Just you got parking on 12th. When you get on 12th and it's a problem, it's because of the parking. And then, like Anastasia, I mean, with two additional stop signs, maybe something would happen at Seneca, but I don't see the need to take it out. I use that stop sign 5 times a day, and it does what it needs to do for me.
You're talking at Seneca?
Seneca, like I right now I wouldn't support pulling one at Seneca.
I will happily support pulling one at Seneca.
Yeah.
So if you need a second, I'll second before. All right, any other discussion? All right, so motion is made by Alderman Bennion and seconded by Alderman Anastasia. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Opposed. So the motion carries. Five. And it's referred to tonight's regular meeting. Next we have PL 68-23 by Alderman Bennion to authorize the removal of a stop sign on the front at its intersection with Seneca Avenue. You want to talk about the logic behind that one, Alderman Bennion?
Well, it was kind of a mix. Some was people thought there was two. That sign was put in there temporarily when Front Street, which is a no-truck route, was to be temporarily used for truck during the reconstruction of North Union Street. Then it was advocated to become a permanent fixture thereafter. I also believe that going back a little bit to the Spring Street one, that's going to lend its hand to more vehicles not hitting the bridge, which is at that intersection, if they're already stopped and slowed down. The one in Seneca, and I get that Alderman Panis uses it five times a day. So when you're in that area, which obviously a lot, the number of vehicles, especially oversized vehicles that strike that bridge, have also ran the stop sign because you come around that corner and then there's the stop sign. We could say there's a sign that says low bridge, but over the years that's proved to be not work very well. I know that Director Thompson and I also talked about, would you think that was about $10,000, one of them advanced warning systems? I know it was a speculation.
Yeah, it's hard to say.
It's a laser that goes across the road that then would trigger lights so that way they're not going off all the time, that would trigger it and then say, hey, stop and turn around if they're on that road. So the logic for me is that stop sign is not serving its purpose, and it served its purpose as a temporary stop.
I've already put my 2 cents in. I think now, personally, I'm in favor of removing that. If the council wishes to add two more stop signs, I'm in favor of removing that one. I've always hated that one.
Just real quick.
Director Thompson.
That is probably the highest area for pedestrians going from there over towards the park and that whatnot in that area. And if you want to look at pedestrian accidents, we've only had 5 in the last 5 years. 2 of them were at parking lots on that street. And the other 3, there was one at corner of East State Front, Main Street Front, and the only other pedestrian accident was at Seneca. Not a Prospect, not a Spring. So that's the only place at these intersections we've had a pedestrian hit. And there's a high volume of pedestrians crossing in that area. And I guess I don't understand the logic here if you say, we want to put up signs to stop people, but down here they're not paying attention to us, so take it out. That doesn't really follow any sound engineering practice, so just because they're ignoring it, we're going to add more here and take that out. I guess I fail to see the logic there.
Okay. Yes, of course, Mr. Mayor.
I'm totally against removing the stop signs. You have a blind intersection there. You're going, I guess you could say, going westbound, to try to make, I think it was said here earlier, to try to make a left-hand turn out of East Spring Street and Prospect. It's almost impossible at times. I think if you remove the stop signs to make a left-hand turn, it is going to be impossible. It's also a safety feature. There's a lot of children that use that crossing, especially now in the summer, going to the parks, going to War Vets Park. So I think it's a safety issue. I know you said that they're stopped at Spring Street, but it also gives these campers and trucks the opportunity to stop there and not hit the bridge at 30 miles an hour. So that's just my 2 cents.
That's a good one. Alderman Robinson.
I'm going to actually piggyback the mayor on that one. That particular stop sign, I believe, should definitely stay. I believe that I used to live in, actually when I first moved here, I lived in East Olean a long time ago. That stop sign was not there, and I hated it. When I moved from the area, they put the stop sign there, like Alderman Bingham said, when they did the construction, and that sign popped up. But I believe that sign should stay, and I believe that it's a good first step for any vehicles, like the mayor said, any campers, any trucks, to stop and literally identify the sign there that says 10 foot, 10 inches, or whatever it is there. I think that's the sign. And before they try to go up underneath it. So if that's the only deterrent that we have right there, then I think that's perfect.
All right, anyone else? Okay, seeing none, is there a motion?
Sponsor.
All right, sponsor is made by Alderman Bennion. I'll second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Opposed.
Me.
What?
Yeah.
I'll be opposed.
You're opposed?
Yes.
You're opposed? You're
yes.
Aye. You're a yes.
You want to remove it?
Do I want to remove yes?
You want the sign?
I'm sorry.
You might just stay, so you're opposed to the...
You're opposed
to... No, you already voted. No, you already voted.
You're opposed to...
You already voted to tie. The mayor gets to break. That gets turned down 2-4. Okay. So...
It's going on for a real vote, right?
No.
No, okay.
So we're keeping it. We're keeping three.
We're getting three. And I'll see your three if Dave removes that stop sign on 4th Street.
I can put it up.
You can remove it.
So can you.
Worst stop sign in order.
Never did say that.
All right. So that one gets turned down 2-4. 4-2. All right. I'll make a motion to adjourn. Can I get a second?
Second.
All in favor, aye, opposed, motion carried. All right, I'll call to order the regular meeting of the Common Council Tuesday, July 25th, 2023. Will the clerk please call the attendance roll?
Alderman Bennion?
Here.
Alderman Panis?
Here.
Alderwoman Fornick? Alderwoman McCall?
Here.
Alderwoman Robinson?
What? Yes, here.
Alderman Anastasia?
Here.
And President Crawford?
Here. Please rise for the invocation of the pledge.
Lord, we are meeting today to conduct matters of business. Guide our hearts and our minds in the spirit of fairness, right thought, and speech. Impart your supreme wisdom upon our activities so that our affairs may reach a successful conclusion. Thank you for being our source of guidance today.
Reading, correcting, and approval of minutes of the previous regular meeting.
Regular meeting of the Olean Common Council was held on Tuesday, July 11, 2023, at 6:40 p.m. Present were Alderman Crawford, Bennion, Panis, Forney, McCall, Robinson, and Anastasia. None are absent.
I'll make a motion to approve the minutes of the previous regular meeting. Can I get a second?
Second.
Second by Alderman Robinson. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Committee reports and unfinished council business.
None.
Communications from the mayor.
Thank you. I just have a resignation from Tim Bowser. Tim Bowser is retiring after 38 years of service with the Olean Police Department. His retirement date will be August 15, 2023. So I'd like to take this opportunity to thank Tim for all his years of service to the police department and the city of Olean. So, and I wish him luck in his retirement.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
I'm all good. I'm good. Thank you.
Miscellaneous communications.
Monthly report of the city auditor. Month ended June 30th, 2023. Financial summary report as of June 30th, 2023.
Proposed legislation and referrals.
PL number 63-23 from President Crawford. Referred to regular meeting Tuesday, July 25th, 2023 for resolution by Council President. PL number 64-23 by Mayor Elio. Referred to regular meeting Tuesday, July 25th, 2023 for resolution by Council President. PL number 65-23 by Mayor Haleo. Referred to Committee of the Whole Tuesday, July 25th, 2023 by Council President. PL number 66-23 by Alderman Bennion. Referred to Committee of the Whole Tuesday, July 25th, 2023 by Council President. PL number 67-23 by Alderman Bennion, referred to Committee of the Whole Tuesday, July 25th, 2023 by Council President. PL number 68-23 by Alderman Bennion, referred to Committee of the Whole Tuesday, July 25th, 2023 by Council President.
Okay, before I open it up to public comment, I'd like to give an opportunity to any Alder.
I just like to.
Alderman Anastasia.
I'd just like to thank Director Thompson. We're installing crosswalks and the bike emblems on North Union Street. It really looks nice down there, so thank your staff for that. Yeah. And also, I'd like to thank Fire Chief for Coates. I had a code complaint, and Sean was on top of it and got the final resolve. So, also thank your department. That's it.
Okay. Anything else? All right. Will the clerk please read the public comment statement?
Public comment portion of the Common Council regular meeting is established to provide members of the community with the opportunity to publicly state their views, voice their concerns, or to provide input pertaining to any issue affecting city government. Additionally, the mayor, Common Council members, and city department heads encourage any person with questions to contact them at their office.
All right, at this time, I would invite any of the members of the public to approach the podium, state your name and address for the record. You have 5 minutes.
Hi, everyone. My name is Andrew Hitchcock. I live at 1406 Highland Terrace here in the city. 2 weeks ago, my neighbor and I came in, expressed some concerns about a neighbor of ours that is disrupting our enjoyment of our property. And I was just curious if there had been any discussion about it or anything like that, maybe moving forward with something.
So just to let you know, as far as typically a public comment goes, it's not really a Q&A.
Okay.
So best recommendation would be to follow up with the mayor, follow up with your alderman for having that conversation.
All right.
To get more details. If you have more that you would like to share with us at this time, by all means.
All right. I guess at this time I wouldn't have anything else to say other than do I email my alderman?
That would work.
Oh, okay. Oh, that'd be great. Yes. Yeah.
You could just 372-7776.
72-7776. Okay.
And as far as following up on a matter like that, sir, that would be the best course.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah. All right, good. Yeah, that's great. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. Thank you. 7776. Got it. Thank you.
Okay, anything else? All right, at this time, I'll call the public comment closed. Time to finance and bills.
The auditor has processed bills and claims against the city of Olean. As per this, submitted to each alderman and recommends payment thereof. Whereas the auditor has presented to the Common Council bills and claims against the City of Olean totaling $1,498,911.06 for the budget and recommends payment thereof. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the same be and are hereby audited and allowed, and the auditor is hereby authorized and directed to draw warrants for the payment thereof at the amount set opposite each respective claim.
Okay, we all got our finance and bills. Any comments or questions? Seeing none, will the clerk please, I'll make a motion. Can I get a second?
Sure.
Seconded by Alderman Bannis. Will the clerk please call the roll?
Alderman Bennion?
Yes.
Alderman Bannis?
Yes.
Alderwoman McCall?
Yes.
Alderman Robinson?
Yes.
Alderman Anastasia?
Yes.
President Crawford?
Yes.
Resolution passes 6 ayes, no nays.
On to resolutions.
I'm sorry. Local law number 04-2023, PL number 56-23, by Alderman Crawford, seconded by Alderman Robinson. A local law establishing uniform guidelines for determining the responsibility of bidders.
Okay, if you remember our conversation from a couple weeks ago, this is just removing that $50,000 credit to local county bidders, trying to level the playing field and increase the amount of competition bidding on our contracts here in the city of Olean. Any comments or questions? Seeing none, will the clerk please call the roll?
Alderman Benyon?
Yes.
Alderman Panis?
Yes.
Alderman McCall?
Yes.
Alderman Robinson?
Yes.
Alderman Anastasia?
Yes.
And President Crawford?
Yes.
Resolution passes 6 ayes, 2 nays. Resolution number 59-23, PL number 57-23, to authorize the installation of signage indicating no bicycles, electric bicycles, or electric scooters on sidewalks with the business district as defined in section 24-257 of the City of Olean Code of Ordinances.
Okay, discuss this in committee of the whole. We said we would be utilizing the minutes as far as the locations of the approximate 8 signs in our business district. Any comments or questions? Seeing none, I'll make a motion. Could I get a second, please?
Second.
Will the clerk please call the roll?
Alderman Benyon?
Yes.
Alderman Panis?
Yes.
Alderman McCall?
Yes.
Alderman Robinson?
Yes.
Alderman Anastasia?
Yes.
And President Crawford?
Yes.
Resolution passes 6 ayes, 1 nays. Resolution number 64-23, PL number 62-23, to amend the City of Olean Code of Ordinances section 14-3, open alcoholic beverage containers.
All right, we talked about this a couple of weeks ago. Any comments or questions?
I wasn't here for that.
No, you weren't. Okay, I'll entertain a sponsor.
I'll sponsor.
Sponsored by Alderman McCall.
Sir.
Second by Alderman Panis. Will the clerk please call the roll?
Alderman Benyon?
Yes.
Alderman Panis?
Yes.
Alderman McCall?
Yes.
Alderman Robinson?
Yes.
Alderman Anastasia?
Yes.
President Crawford?
Yes.
Resolution passes 6 ayes, 0 nays. Resolution number 65-23, PL number 63-23, to amend the City of Olean Code of Ordinances, section 24-135, to prohibit parking on the west side of North 7th Street for a distance of 25 feet from its intersection with Reed Street, and on the south side of Reed Street for a distance of 25 feet from its intersection with North 7th Street.
Talked about this in committee. Any comments or questions? Seeing none, I'll sponsor. Could I get a second?
I'll second.
Second by Alderman Robinson. Will the clerk please call the roll?
Alderman Benyon?
Yes.
Alderman Panis?
Yes.
Alderman McCall?
Yes.
Alderman Robinson?
Yes.
Alderman Anastasia?
Yes.
And President Crawford?
Yes.
Resolution passes 6 ayes, 2 nays.
All right, so I'll make a motion to suspend the rules. Could I get a second, please?
Sir.
Second by Alderman Panis. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? I'll make a motion to amend the amount in Resolution 66-23 to equal $188,228.59. Could I get a second?
Second.
Second by Alderman Benyon. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carried. Please continue, Mr. Clerk.
Alderman Benyon?
Yes.
We have the
sponsor.
Read the resolution.
Okay. Resolution authorizing the transfer of funds from Capital Fund Number 213 to American Rescue Plan Act to newly created Capital Fund Number 231, John Jay Ash Community Center EVAC Project.
All right, we talked about moving the additional funds to finalize the HVAC project over at the John Ash Center in committees. We've got the right amount in there, moving it from our ARPA into that capital project. Any comments or questions?
Just who sponsored?
Nobody, yeah.
haven't gotten.
You ready to jump in?
Sure.
Okay. Sponsored by Alderman Anastasia. Somebody looking to jump in second? Oh, Panis is looking at me.
All right. Sorry.
Seconded by Alderman Panis. All right, local clerk. Any discussion? Will the clerk please call the roll?
Alderman Benyon?
Yes.
Alderman Panis?
Yes.
Alderwoman McCall?
Yes.
Alderman Robinson?
Yes.
Alderman Anastasia?
Yes.
And President Crawford?
Yes.
Resolution passes 6 ayes, 1 nay. Resolution number 67-23, PL number 65-23, out of committee by Alderwoman McCall, seconded by Alderman Anastasia. Resolution authorizing the transfer of funds from general fund contingency to line item 1410.411.
Okay, we talked about this in committee of the whole. Any comments or questions? Seeing none, will the clerk please call the roll?
Alderman Benyon?
Yes.
Alderman Panis?
Yes.
Alderwoman McCall?
Yes.
Alderman Robinson?
Yes.
Alderman Anastasia?
Yes.
And President Crawford?
Yes.
Resolution passes 6 ayes, 4 nays. Resolution number 68-23, PL number 66-23, out of committee by Alderman Benyon, seconded by Alderman Robinson, to authorize the installation of stop signs on Front Street at its intersection with Prospect Avenue.
Okay, talked about this. Comments, questions? If none, will the clerk please call the roll?
Alderman Benyon?
Yes.
Alderman Panis?
Yes.
Alderwoman McCall?
Yes.
Alderman Robinson?
Yes.
Alderman Anastasia?
Yes.
And President Crawford?
Yes.
Resolution passes 6 ayes, no nays. Resolution number 69-23, PL number 67-23, out of committee by Alderman Benyon, seconded by Alderman Anastasia, to authorize the installation of a stop sign on Front Street at its intersection with Spring Street.
Okay, comments, questions? Seeing none, will the clerk please call the roll?
Alderman Benyon?
Yes.
Alderman Panis?
Yes.
Alderwoman McCall?
Yes.
Alderman Robinson?
Yes.
Alderman Anastasia?
Yes.
And President Crawford?
No.
Resolution passes 5 ayes, 1 nay.
Okay. That is it for tonight, right, Mr. Mayor?
Yeah, resolution of the last one did not get on the committee.
What?
Mayor, were you, we had an email just about executive session on something. Were you going to?
Mayor had it tonight.
Okay.
Jack, I couldn't be here. I said the attorney was here.
Okay.
I will, if you give me a call, I can explain.
Okay, perfect, thank you.
Okay, anything else, guys? Seeing none, I'll make a motion to adjourn. Can I get a second?
Second.
Second by Alderman McCall. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Try to beat you, Jason.